Okay, these were the ghosts in our machine, and I now want to ask some people to the floor, our panelists of today. But first of all, I think someone of the Party for the Animals? No. Oh, they talk afterwards. Okay. Then I want to ask to the floor, first of all, the director of the film, the co-producer. Liz Marshall, of course, and the main protagonist, the photographer in the film, Anne McArthur. I have that too. Please. And finally, internationally well-known animal welfare lawyer, Antoine Goetschel. Please sit down. Thank you all, first of all, for participating in this wonderful film. Do please sit down. My idea for this extended Q&A, which will take about half an hour, is that in the first 15 minutes, I will ask some general questions to all of our three speakers. And then hopefully it will last about 15 minutes before you can stop yourself and want to scream and shout to us and at least want to participate in the discussion. So in the second half of the Q&A, I will give, well, at least some of you the opportunity to ask some questions as well and participate in the discussion that will follow. Okay, then first of all, when I look at the movie, not so much as an animal studies scholar, but even more so as a committed human animal being, so to speak. I think what was said in the film about your pictures, they were upsetting and they were powerful. I think that applies to the film itself as well. And for me, well, one of my reactions, well, at least at some moments in the film, was I had some moments of despair, thinking by myself, well, as I said, as a committed person, thinking by myself, well, how far have we come with the animal welfare or animal rights movement in the past one or two or more decades, maybe starting from the 1970s, from a publication like Animal Liberation by Peter Singer. Where have we come from? So I wanted to start with Antoine to pose you a general question, just to uplift me and probably some of the members in the audience as well. What have we achieved over the past decades in terms of animal rights, or in terms of animal welfare, which term would you prefer? And of course, and probably you can make a distinction between as Switzerland is a very well specific case in point. I think maybe make a separation between between the general developments internationally and Switzerland as a specific case in point. It's a broad question, but
so
then again,
first of all, I want
where did
to
we come?
Thank you, Liz. Thank you, Jo-Anne, very, very much. This movie is so touching and soul and mind opening for a lot of us. You know it, what is behind. I know it also for 30 years I'm working in, but the majority of the people does not know what they eat, what they take medication, how they are produced, etc. From that point of view, I have the impression that we speak more, generally speaking, of animals in society than 30 years ago when Ruth Harrison started with Animal Machine in the 60s, Peter Singer and others. So it was a niche to speak off, and now it's getting bigger and bigger, the movement. As far as the vegans are concerned, still they are a very small group. Vegetarians, they are a little bit bigger, but will never make a majority. And for that, I do hope that this very impressive movie will kind of make a big step ahead to explain or to show what is behind it. For that, thank you very much. It might be possible, if we are in a little society, let's say, for example, Switzerland, I'm coming from, to move minds. We can take responsibility for a small part of a society, and we can stand up and say, we don't want that. And by that, we started to have an eye on animal welfare legislation, at least, to make structures. And if we say animal matters, animals do matter in society, then it means we expect also from the state to do something, and nobody in the room will say yes to animal mistreatment, so we can expect from the state to ban animal mistreatment, and by that, I think instead of fighting what is better, animal welfare or animal rights, it's to make steps ahead and to increase animal welfare legislation, to have it at least that we feel in a society well with the way that our society treats animals, and to have a good way of law enforcement, and to speak as we do, for example, in Switzerland, to speak of the dignity of animals, or in the Dutch Animal Welfare Act, of the intrinsic value of animals. We feel it, and now we can expect from all the responsible people to react on that, and I think it's high time, and we should do something, because the direction, as you showed at the end, goes in the wrong direction as far as we see it. So we should stand up and expect from politicians, from lawmakers, and from the majority of the society to stand up and to show and to discuss the issue.
Well, just before going into the more recent developments in Switzerland, but I think you're suggesting that over the past decades we have seen some shift in our ideas about animals in general, which is quite some shift, I think, or isn't it?
Well, it's more to the ladies to say that, but in the...
Well, from a law point of view.
From the law point of view, to stand up for a better legal position of animals in society, it's easier now to declare it. When I started in the 80s, they thought, what a crazy person to do so. And I feel that the issue is getting taken much more seriously in Australia and in New Zealand. There are courses, animal welfare law or animal law is taught. And from that point of view, there is hope that law, because law is kind of key in society, law is taken more seriously. But by the end of the day, we have to see that the lobbying group of the animal users are very powerful, and maybe the law is the way to make something happen.
Okay, just before I go to the ladies, one last question about Switzerland. Yeah. What makes Switzerland? I've always wondered over the last years, what makes Switzerland such a specific country in terms of animal law, or is there no?
So we have in 1992 we changed the constitution. So first we have the animals in the constitution. I do not think that it's in the Netherlands, it's not in UK, it's not in the US. So animals in the constitution show that a society take animals seriously. Second, we put in the term of the dignity of animals in Swiss constitution, meaning we do not only protect animals against suffering and pain. This is the first step, and what we have seen is that we should start with taking this ban on suffering and the mistreatment seriously, but behind that we accept sort of a right, or at least a moral issue in the dignity of creature, as we also protect the dignity of human beings. And also the law enforcement, we made quite strong in Switzerland, and I was there, for example, for 3 years, the worldwide unique animal welfare attorney, standing up for all the mistreated animals and give them a voice in every court case in the canton of Zurich. So by that, the society there said, yes, animals do matter, and some of these aspects can play as kind of a role model also for the Netherlands, for UK, and also for Canada, that we met in Montreal several years ago.
Yeah. Okay. Going from the law to media, to society in general. Liz, you as a filmmaker, do you recognize this shift Antoine is talking about, or is there really a new wave about in our thinking about animals?
Yes, I think there is, and when I started developing the ghosts in our machine in a really active way, because often, as a filmmaker, ideas start years before and they start incubating, and they're more seeds that are growing over time. And I refer to that more as a passive development phase. But when I started developing the film and putting the team together to make this film, that was about 3 years ago. And when I decided to feature Jo-Anne and her story, and part of her story in the film, of course, is the trajectory of Jo-Anne trying to get her work published on a broader scale. And I wanted to feature that storyline really as a symbol, as a way of illustrating and paralleling the challenges that exist in mainstream media culture. So on one hand, what we're seeing, and this is what I learned very quickly when I started researching and developing the film, is that there's a wave, almost like a zeitgeist, that's happening right now around awareness, consciousness. We see it in mainstream media, and we see it in celebrity culture. We see it at the academic level. We see it at the political and legal level. So this is something that's starting to emerge, and it's very exciting. And it's really on the heels of the green environmental revolution. And so we feel that it's very fertile, the timing right now, to release the film and to comment on dominant culture, dominant media culture, which is, of course, a main story thread in the movie, because the power of the image, the power of documentary as a platform to convey ideas and to open people's eyes is why I do what I do as a filmmaker. And this festival, IDFA, is a perfect example of a worldwide stage for presenting all kinds of documentaries that are trying to communicate ideas. And some ideas, like this one, are not as popular. They're still stigmatized, marginalized, and not even sometimes taken very seriously at all. I come from a background of being a human rights documentary filmmaker, and my last film focuses on the environment. So when I started focusing on this, I became almost painfully aware of the challenges that exist for this social movement. That said, there's the flip side, which is that this social movement is the most, I have to say, in some ways, almost the most passionate that I've ever tapped into. The degree of passion and loyalty and empathy is pretty profound, and it's really changed me as a person.
About this flip side, about the negative aspects, for you yourself, did you feel any opposition? Where was the concrete opposition?
Opposition in terms of getting the film
against
made?
Against the production of this film, or against the subject, or whatever, in the course of the production of it?
I guess the best way to answer that question would be that there's always a polarized view about the film. There's nothing in the middle. So either there's complete disinterest, like just dismissing it, either as an idea to get it off the ground in the first place, or as a finished film, or there's total praise for it. So in that way, I think that's quite interesting. It's not middle of the road. It doesn't, it evokes a dramatic response in people. There's a trigger kind of response to this issue, I think, because people are confronted with it every single day. Where each of us are confronted with it every single day. So I think that it triggers an interesting response. I just want to quickly say that one of the favorite reviews that I've read actually was written by a film professor and theorist in Canada. And she said that the film is not about empathy, but that it's a film that dwells in empathy. And so for people that are not comfortable with that space, they might not know what to do. Whereas a lot of people are finding that they want to go to that place, or they're naturally able to go to that place, and then they have a different kind of experience. So I like that.
Jo-Anne, you must immediately recognize all of this.
I'd like to add to that, actually. Liz's comment is that people either dismiss the film or are in praise and in favor of it, but I'll also add that people also react with fear. There's a lot of fear to this, and I think that's because, you know, in my 10, 15 years of doing animal rights work, what I've seen is that people love animals, and no one wants to see them get hurt. So first of all, they're doing this, like, oh, I can't see animals getting hurt. But to face animal cruelty is also to face something else, and that's our complicity in the cruelty. And we all take part in it because we live in this world. So we have two things to face, and facing ourselves as well and having to make change is a big thing. And so we're, you know, we are up against a lot, and that's why the movement is slow, but it is growing. We see more groups, you know, every day and every year, more animal activist groups on the worldwide scale and grassroots. So things are changing for sure for the better.
Okay, I think they are changing, but then again, as we see in the film for ourselves, you face some difficulty. And that would be my question: Is it becoming more or less? You're facing some difficulty in getting your pictures published. Is that becoming less? What is your concrete experience with that?
Well, not just in my experience, but other photographers and other people doing undercover work, we are seeing that in the media more and more. Big publications as well, like the New York Times. Almost not a week goes by these days that there isn't some kind of coverage of animal rights issues. So my work and the work of others is definitely getting published more.
I can actually give a concrete sort of answer to that as well, which is that we've just come here from being in New York and LA. Jo-Anne and I have been on the road together for the last while, releasing the film. And in New York, it was held over theatrically, and in LA, it was held over theatrically. And the film has received in the US really stunning reviews in the LA Times, the New York Times, and the Village Voice. So I think that is also a reflection of what we're talking about right now, which is that mainstream culture, mainstream media, is starting to take this seriously or starting to view it differently.
I should also plug my book, because speaking of getting the work out there, you see me working on my book in the film, and we've already sold out of the first print run, and it's not even out yet. So that's a good indication as well. There are postcards for the book just outside the door if you want to pick one up on your way out.
Now, before I return to Antoine, first a question to both of you, in fact, making films and making pictures. I heard that your idea about what is the aim of your pictures is to document, you said, or I heard you mentioned in the film, to document and to educate. Now, my idea was that there is something in between, which is maybe the most important one and the most difficult one, is to make people aware of. things?
Sure. Well, there are a lot of photographers out there documenting animals, the beauty of animals, the inquisitiveness and the fascination that we have with animals. But I wouldn't say that these are images that are exposing why they're going extinct and why they're hidden by the billions behind doors. So a lot of the photography and the work that's out there just further objectifies, actually, animals. So what I'm trying to do is take a step back and show our role in their lives. And that's why you see the machinery around them, whether it's the milking machines or the trucks that they're in or the hands that are picking up the animals for slaughter. Because really, my work is about us. It's about the animals, yeah. But it's about looking at what we do so that we can turn the lens inward and reflect on our actions and create change.
Okay.
What she said.
Okay. Because we have only little time left, before I go to you for some final word, let's have one or two questions from the audience. In the back somewhere. I see a finger over there. The mic is coming to you. The mic is coming to you so that we can hear you all loud and clear.
I buy organic milk and cheese. Did I understand correctly, seeing the documentary, that that's also very harmful for animals?
As I say in the documentary, those are actually the cruelest industries. People often, when they want to deal with cruelty and get it out of their diet, they cut out the larger animals. But indeed, if you look at the amount of suffering in the shortest amount of time, it's the layer hens who suffer the most, and the dairy cows. And you can look up all sorts of information about that on both of our websites, theghostsinourmachine.org and .com, and weanimals.org. I love hearing that people are making changes to be more ethical consumers, so that's amazing, and I hope everyone keeps taking steps in that direction. When people ask me, well, you know, is it okay to eat these kinds of things? I'm not here to be a judge. I'm just here to put information out there and help people make decisions. But there's a sanctuary in Australia, and it's called Edgar's Mission, and I absolutely love their motto. And it's very simple, and it answers everything for me. And their motto is, if we can lead happy and healthy lives without harming others, then why wouldn't we?
Okay.
I'd just like to acknowledge that we have really an amazing audience here tonight, and as part of that amazing audience, we've got some animal organizations that are here, but we also have an elected politician with us, and her name is Esther. Where are you from the Party for the Animals? If you could just stand up. All we hand. Yeah. Thank you for coming. We'd love to hear from you as well, if there's something that you'd like to say or pose a question.
Please do.
And
thank you.
There's a group here called Eyes on Animals as well.
Eyes on Animals.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Thank you all for coming. Ooh, this light is bright. I want to say just two things. I am so impressed with your work, Jo-Anne. I can't imagine how difficult it must be to enter those facilities and look at the animals and then having to leave and leave them behind. You're so courageous. Thank you so much for your inspiration. And thank you, Liz, for following Jo-Anne, making this wonderful movie. Maarten, I understand you said, I felt some kind of despair because there are so many animals still in the industry yet, and how long has it been since we've talked about animal rights? Well, I understand, but we have a big fight and a big struggle ahead of us. Are we patient? No, we are not. We don't want to end factory farming in a year or in a few weeks. We want it ended yesterday. But are we dedicated to hold on? You bet. And I feel so much power coming from you and all the other people supporting us, and this growing awareness about having to cut down on our meat consumption. It's a big achievement of our party here in the Netherlands that we get politics to acknowledge that we cannot eat animals in the way that we do now and in the amount that we do now. So we're getting there, but we have to hold on. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Okay.
That's the Party for the Animals. They have two elected politicians in Parliament.
And then, by way of a final word, to Antoine, and in relation to what Esther already said, we are going on. That is the party and probably we as an audience and as filmmakers here on the stage, we are going further and further. Where do we head to at the moment? Where are we going in the next few years, or where should we be going?
So I sat there and started to give water to the charming ladies, and I thought of Lou Reed's masterpiece with the title The Power of Positive Drinking. So inside of positive thinking, we should focus on of being part of the solution and not of the problem. Everyone here in the room, you as a politician, you as a filmmaker, as a photographer, we have, I think, a responsibility, or we feel better if we can be part of the solution and find others that share our vision. From my point of view, I think it's not about aggression or about impatience. It's about warming up others to this issue and to say, how can we as a society just be tolerant to this issue? And by that, from my legal point of view, I think it's getting much more easier to speak with politicians from the farm industry or the chemical industry, and to give them solutions that they can step in and make a change, be it in the Netherlands, helping also Germany to have something done in the EU, or also maybe just in one small state of Canada, and to make it in Canada, and then coming down to New York, to US. So I think if we can try to avoid hatred and to warm up just our feeling of we don't want this any longer, it's easier to find friends that can make a change, be it in science, like Don Broom since the 70s, 80s, in politics, in the arts, and everyone who can speak freely on its emotion and its decision should be supported. So I think we are in a good way, in a good position to make change and to take our responsibility to make something good.
The beautiful last words I hoped for. Thank you, Antoine. Thank you, Liz. Thank you, Jo-Anne. Thank you, Esther. And thank you for the audience for being here present and for your attention. This probably isn't the first one you saw about animals. It's probably has been one of the most beautiful one to watch, but it certainly won't be the last one. Thank you.
We'll be out in the lobby for more question and answers. We're sorry that there wasn't more from the floor, but thanks again for coming. Thank you so much. There's two more screenings at IDFA. We're leaving tomorrow, but there's two more screenings, so please tell people that you know. Thank you. Thank you.